So now it's my distinct pleasure to introduce our first keynote speaker, Preet Bharara. Preet, as you know, is the U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of New York. And that office is at the forefront of many important criminal and civil issues, including international narcotics and arms trafficking, terrorism, white-collar crime, public corruption, and civil rights violations, just to name a few. Preet's accomplishments are far too many for me to list here. Since his appointment as U.S. Attorney in August 2009, Preet has led the office in handling any number of significant cases, including prosecutions of one of the most notorious armed traffickers in the world, Viktor Bout of Russia, Times Square bomber Faisal Shahzad, and one of the al-Qaeda plotters of the American embassy bombing in East Africa. Before he was the U.S. attorney from 2000 to 2005, Preet served as an AUSA in that same office in the Southern District of New York, where he prosecuted a wide range of cases involving organized crime, racketeering, securities fraud, money laundering, narcotics trafficking, among others. And of course, in April of this year, Time magazine named Preet as one of the world's most influential, 100 most influential people. So please join me in welcoming my colleague and my friend, the U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of New York, Preet Bharara.
Thank you, Tony, for that introduction. It's really an honor to be here. I'm a little humbled to be here. I've never spoken in the Great Hall before. No one has ever let me speak in any hall that is called Great. I've sat there a number of times, but never up here, and it's a humbling thing to be here. I also want to acknowledge and thank the other keynote speaker, Gervin Miyamoto from Hawaii, who backstage a few minutes ago invited me to come out to Hawaii anytime I want. I'm gonna take him up on that. It's really great to be here to talk about the theme of today's celebration and celebrations like this that are happening around the country, striving for excellence in leadership, diversity, and inclusion. And, you know, just to give you a sense of how much diversity and leadership there is in this community, I have that in my own family. My brother, who's a little bit younger than I am, let me tell you just a quick story. He was a little bit younger than I am, also went to law school, and has shown in the Bharara family how much diversity there can be in leadership. He and I began with very similar backgrounds. We both went to Columbia Law School. I graduated in 1993. He graduated 3 years after I did. He and I both went to law firms in New York. He and I then both went to smaller law firms to get more litigation experience. Then our paths sort of changed directions a little bit. I decided to go to the U.S. Attorney's Office, which is the best decision I ever made. My brother decided to start an internet company at the height of the internet bubble, in which I invested and lost all my money. He then luckily landed a job when that company was saved and purchased. I then at some point went to work in the United States Senate, in the Senate Judiciary Committee, which was an amazing experience. My brother was doing fine, got married, had a couple of kids, was stable. I became aware that I might become the United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York, and then I became the U.S. Attorney in the Southern District of New York, so I figured in my family I was doing pretty well. My brother decided that at that point he was going to start another company, and he calls me up and he says, Preet, I'm going to start another company. And I said, okay, I hope this one doesn't lose money. And he said, I hope not. And I said, what's the company? He said, I think that my best friend and I are going to go sell diapers. And I said, like door to door, you're going to sell diapers? What? And he said, no, we're going to sell diapers on the internet. My best friend and I, who started the first company in which I lost money, are going to start this company. And I said, you're going to do it on the side while you maintain your job and you have health care and all those things that you have? And he said, no, we're going to quit our jobs. We're going to use all our life savings, and we're going to start this company where we sell diapers on the internet. And I said, knock yourself out. So then I became the U.S. attorney and got to preside over an office of some of the most amazing lawyers I've ever met. And I thought I had a pretty cool job, and I do. And then my brother calls me up a couple of years into my job, or a year and a half into my job, and said, I just want to let you know, Preet, that later today, Amazon.com is announcing that they're buying my diaper company for $540 million. I don't know why people always groan when I tell that story, which was basically my brother's way of saying, you know, hey, bro, I see your whole U.S. attorney thing, and I raise you $540 million. So I'm hoping that that diversity lesson teaches us all something, and he will include me in some of his newfound wealth. In any event, I got to have the most amazing experience that one could ever have, the greatest achievement that I think I can say that I've had in my time as U.S. attorney. And you may agree with me, given the makeup of the audience here today, was not any of the cases that Tony mentioned or some of the others that he didn't mention, but that I got to meet Jeremy Lin. Pretty amazing thing. It was the first time my wife has actually been impressed with me. The Justice Department, I will tell you, for those of you who are in the Justice Department, is really one of the most amazing institutions, I think, in American life. It is the great honor and privilege of my life to serve as a U.S. attorney in the Southern District of New York, and I have a feeling, I always say, that no matter how long I live and no matter what else I do, it will remain the great honor of my life. The single proudest day of my professional life was when I was sworn in as an assistant U.S. attorney by Mary Jo White in New York. And every single time I stood up before a judge and got to say, Preet Bharara for the government, Your Honor, was a proud day for me. Throughout the Justice Department, there is unbelievable and amazing work being done in every single area of criminal prosecution, from terrorism to public corruption to violent crime to every single stripe of fraud. And it's work that everyone should be proud of, no matter where you're from or what your background is. I have to realize every day when I'm in the U.S. Attorney's Office that I have a lot to live up to in the Southern District of New York. Those who have served in my office have gone on to become mayor, governor, secretary of war, attorney general, Supreme Court justice. Their names include those like Stimson, Dewey, Root, Harlan, Frankfurter, and Morgenthau. And it's quite a legacy that I feel is before me in that office. And lest I ever forget that legacy, for those of you who have been to my office, you know that on the hallway approaching my office on the 8th floor, there's a wall of photographs, and there's a photograph of every single prior United States attorney going back to the beginning of the century. So I see their faces every single day. I sometimes think that Giuliani is looking at me a little funny, but I'm sure that's just my imagination. As much as I'm reminded by that wall of photos of the massive shoes I have to fill, though, I'm also frequently reminded of the special privilege it is to represent the United States of America as someone who was not even born in the United States, as someone who emigrated to the United States at the age of 2. And that is a fact, I think you'll agree, that says a lot more about America than about any abilities that I may have. And I think given today's celebration, I think it's only fitting to speak for a few minutes about the significance of the immigrant's journey from being an outsider to being a part of the American fabric, an essential part of which is the American justice system. One reminder of the poignance of that immigrant journey came in the form of a letter from the parents of an assistant U.S. attorney I had just hired. This is a couple of years ago, which I actually like to read from time to time. And it says this: Dear Mr. Bharara, there are three occasions in our lives that have really stood out in reminding us of how proud we are to be Americans. The first occasion was when we became American citizens. The second occasion was standing at Mount Rushmore in front of our great president's heads and singing the American anthem. The third occasion was when you swore in our daughter as an assistant United States attorney. The ceremony was heart-wrenching and brought back the tears again of pride in America. I will never forget when you said to us that this is reaching the American dream. The specific examples of Asian American success in law and law enforcement continue to be inspiring, and each is a universal reminder of both the immigrant story and the American promise. One reminder came late last year when Miranda Du was confirmed as a district court judge in Nevada. Born in war-torn Vietnam, Judge Du's family left their country when she was just 9 years old. They found asylum in Malaysia, where her family spent a year in refugee camps before ultimately being granted asylum in the United States. Another such reminder came not too long ago when I attended the investiture of Denny Chin to the Second Circuit Court of Appeals in New York. Judge Chin was born some 58 years earlier in Hong Kong and came to America when he was just 2. His father worked as a cook in a Chinese restaurant. His mother was a seamstress. He swore an oath to become a judge on the second highest court in the land and is still the only currently active Asian American circuit court judge in the country. Yet another reminder came even before I became the U.S. attorney, when I got to sit at the confirmation hearing of Judge Kiyo Matsumoto for a seat in Brooklyn. Judge Matsumoto, whose Japanese parents were put in internment camps during World War II, and whose family's faith in American justice must truly have been tried, was sworn in not long ago as a federal district court judge in Brooklyn. Her appointment, in a way, transcended history. And one reminder which might hold special meaning to some of you here today came in 2005, when Won Kim became Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights. Won Kim moved to this country when he was 5 years old, 2 years after his father and mother emigrated here to wash dishes and to work in a garment factory, all to build a better life for their children. Won realized his parents' dream by excelling in school, by serving his country in the Army Reserves, and by becoming the second Asian American, in fact, to serve as the AAG for Civil Rights after Bill Lan Lee 5 years before him. For my own part, my family's journey has also taught me something about history and humility and the American dream. At my swearing in, I talked a bit about my father's reaction to my nomination. You see, for my whole life, my father was a studiously unemotional man. But in the months leading up to my confirmation, he sometimes seemed a bit overwhelmed at the prospect of his son becoming the United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York. But perhaps that was understandable for a man like my father, who was born 70 years ago, halfway across the globe, who grew up in a small village, who lost his mother while still a toddler, who lived for a time in a home without even basic plumbing, and who became the first member of his family ever to go to college. He brought our family to this part of the world some 40 years ago with only a few dollars in his pocket and a hope in his heart that we would have a better life in this country and that his children might one day amount to something in America. And so when you are an Indian immigrant who becomes a naturalized citizen at age 12, who later becomes chief counsel to a United States senator, and who later still is nominated by the first African-American president to become the first Asian-American U.S. attorney in Manhattan, you begin to believe that anything is possible in America. And when you are then confirmed as U.S. attorney, even though your name is an odd-sounding Preet Bharara, when you understand that your photo will nonetheless one day hang on that wall alongside people with names like Henry L. Stimson and Whitney North Seymour Jr. and Robert M. Morgenthau, when your father came from nothing and you have everything, then you know anything is possible in America. In fact, I sometimes feel I will not have enough breaths in my body to give back what I feel I owe my country. And so on the one hand, I understand and appreciate a family's pride and a community's excitement when one of its own makes a mark. It is the historical arc leading ever upward that every immigrant hopes his family will draw. But at the end of the day, whether you are lucky enough to wear a robe or wield a subpoena, neither I nor anyone else will ultimately be judged on the fact that we were the first Asian American this or the first Asian American that. In my view, there is not necessarily much achievement in merely securing a high position. What you do when you get there is what counts, because an Asian American can fail just as miserably as anyone else. It is the quality ultimately of one's work and the strength of one's vision and the power of one's leadership that establishes, at the end of the day, everyone's place as either a pioneer or a placeholder. And there are people all over the world who have never been appointed or elected to anything, who have been the most consequential champions of justice and catalysts for progress. At the end of the day, we should not understate the importance of these milestones, but we should not overstate them either. All of you DOJ lawyers and staff will be judged by how you handle your responsibilities in what is often a tough but exhilarating job. It is a heavy responsibility to come to work every day knowing that real human lives and livelihoods depend on the decisions that you make, on the discretion that you exercise. But boy, I don't think there is any better job in the country than to be an employee of the Department of Justice whose only allegiance is to the truth and whose only duty is to do justice. I often say that there is no one better situated to preserve liberty, promote equality, and prevent cruelty than the person who has genuinely dedicated himself to becoming both a master and a servant of the law. And I believe that today more than ever before. People spend their entire lives waiting for the opportunity to do something meaningful, to have an impact on their community or their country. For so many people, for too many people, that opportunity never comes. And the people like you in this room and throughout the department and the government have that opportunity every single day. And so I hope you cherish it, and I hope you find a way to keep doing your public service job just as long as you possibly can. You know, from time to time, and not just on days like this, I think about where my parents came from, I think about how far they came, and I think about how very much they overcame. And I think about the hopes they harbored for their young sons in a new and strange country, that they might amount to something in America. And I think if there is still something called the American dream, then I have dreamt it, I have lived it, and I hope I never awaken from it. And every last lucky one of you whose J-job is simply to serve the cause of justice is living it too. Thanks very much for having me today.
Preet, thank you very much. There's any doubt, Preet, your words are certainly worthy of a hall that's called great. So, thank you.